We will see about landmark trials which are related to the membranous nephropathy. Membranous nephropathy can be primary or secondary. About 80% of membranous nephropathy, usually because of the primary causes. And it is the most common cause of nephrotic syndrome in adults next to FSGS. It contributes about 40% causes of nephrotic syndrome in adults. Out of the primary, the antibody which is mainly related is the anti-PLA2R, which might be positive in about 80% of the patient. And the other antibody more important to mention is the thrombospondin 7A, which might be associated with the 5% of the cases. Coming to the prognosis, suppose the patient is having membranous nephropathy, for this just remember the number 3. The chance of complete remission, spontaneous complete remission, is about 30%, but 5 to 30%. The chance of partial remission, this 3 is just for remembering the facts, without any treatment, is about 30 to 40%. And about the risk of ESRD, we can do it according to the year wise, at 5 year, 10 year and 15 years, the just multiplied by 3, there is about 15% chances, to be exact 14% chances of ESRD. At 10 year there is around 30% chances of ESRD, exact value is 35% chances. At 15 year there is a chances approximately 45% chances. The risk of ESRD in membranous nephropathy at 5 year, 10 year and 15 year is approximately 15%, 30 and 41%, and chances of complete remission is about 30% and partial remission at about 30%. This is at 5th year. There is one small diagram to show the location of this antibody which are related to the primary membranous nephropathy, that is anti-PLA2R thrombospondin type 1 domain containing 7A. These are located over the So this is endothelium, basement membrane, epithelium. This is the location of these antigens. This is about the causes of secondary membranous nephropathy. The common are hepatitis B, C, HIV, lung cancers, SLE, even onchovasculitis, diabetes, other drugs like NSAIDs, mercury. These are the other secondary causes of membranous nephropathy. What are the treatment options which are available for membranous nephropathy? First, as we all know, modified Ponticelli, where alternative steroid and cyclophosphamide is given for 6 months, and KDIGO recommend this as the first choice. Again, is the Dutch protocol, where monthly methylprednisolone and followed by oral cyclophosphamide for 12 months. Other options are CNI, B-cell depleting agent, that is rituximab, and ACTH. Here, one point to note in the CNI is for cyclosporine, the dose is 3 to 5 mg per kg in divided dose, and the target level is approximately 120 to 200. We can take it as 150 microgram per deciliter. For tacrolimus, the dose is 0.05 to 0.075 mg per kg in divided doses, and the trough level target is 3 to 5. Whereas in nephrotic syndrome, secondary to podocytopathy, the target was 5 to 10. There's a slight changes in the CNI dose. And regarding the ACH dose, it was given at 1 mg every 2 weeks for 6 months. So coming to the topic proper, the landmark trial which are related to the membranous nephropathy. It is starting from 1946, and the important ones are Ponticelli, modified Ponticelli, and the latest trial Gemretux, Mentor, and the Starman trial. And also in the RICYCLE trial. We will see one by one. The first at the beginning, in membranous nephropathy, they started using the steroids. This is the study which was published in 1979. The controlled study of short-term steroid in adults with membranous nephropathy. They have shown the patient who received a steroid did better than the patient who didn't receive it. So coming directly to the... So that was the conclusion of the first study. This is the second study, which is the important study, which is the Ponticelli regimen based study, the controlled trial of methylprednisolone and chlorambucil in idiopathic membranous nephropathy. Here they have taken 67 patients, and the regimen used was pulse steroid was given for 3 days, followed by oral prednisolone at a dose of 0.5 mg per kg per day for 27 days. At the end of the first month, chlorambucil was given at a dose of 0.2 mg per kg per day for 1 month. And this cycle was altered for 6 months. So coming directly to the conclusion, this study have concluded that steroid and chlorambucil, the combination for 6 months, favor remission of the nephrotic syndrome in adult with primary membranous nephropathy and can preserve renal function at least for some years. This was the conclusion. They have shown that the combination of the steroid plus chlorambucil did better than steroid alone. Then comes this modified Ponticelli regimen. The modified Ponticelli regimen currently we are using is based on this one. This is the RCT comparing pulse steroid plus chlorambucil versus pulse steroid plus cyclophosphamide in idiopathic membranous nephropathy. Few details about the study. It's an open label study and they have included age group of 14 up to 65 years. They have included, and the regimen they have used was pulse steroid plus cyclophosphamide or the current modified Ponticelli regimen that we are using. Here the thing was cyclophosphamide was given at a dose of 2.5 mg per kg, and if the total count was less than 5000, the dose was reduced by 50%. So these are the result of the study. Going directly into the conclusion, just able to show the side effect in the chlorambucil and cyclophosphamide group. You can see from this table what are the side effects. And this study have concluded that in nephrotic syndrome with idiopathic membranous nephropathy, both treatment may be effective in favoring remission and preserving the renal function at least for 3 years. Cyclophosphamide have been introduced because of the risk of malignancy which is associated with chlorambucil. That's why the modified Ponticelli regimen was introduced. So the two important studies, Ponticelli and modified Ponticelli, we have seen. Next, coming to the CNIs. This study was published in 2001. Cyclosporine in patient with steroid resistant membranous nephropathy, and it was a randomized controlled trial done by Daniel et al. This is the study details, exclusion criteria, inclusion criteria. And this study have concluded that cyclosporine is an effective therapeutic agent in the treatment of steroid resistant cases of membranous nephropathy, even though high relapse rate occurs. So other details of the study, you can go through the results. What is the difference between the cyclosporine and the placebo group, and what is the primary outcome and the secondary outcome. That and all I didn't discuss, I just went into the conclusion. So far we have seen three important study. This is the just a cover page to show the study was published in 2009, where this anti-PLA2R as target antigen in the primary membranous nephropathy. This study was published in NEJM. And another study published in 2014, a pilot study to determine the dose and effectiveness of ACTH in nephrotic syndrome due to primary membranous nephropathy. So the conclusion is ACTH did reduce the proteinuria in these cases. So rest of the detail you can study from the article once you download this. So coming to the other important study, which is the GEM Retux study published 2 years back. This is the rituximab for severe membranous nephropathy, a 6 month trial with extended follow-up. So this is the abstract of the trial. This was the multi-center open labeled RCT where 80 patients were studied. These were the inclusion criteria. They were randomized to receive rituximab plus NA8. NA8 is non-immunosuppressive antiproteinuric group. Rituximab was given at two doses, that is day 1 and day 8. Day 1 and day 8, they gave it 1 gram dose. And other group did receive only the non-immunosuppressive therapy. If we see the primary outcome, that is complete or partial remission at 6 months, it was 35% in this group and 21% in the group which didn't receive anything. And in the secondary outcome also, anti-PLA2 or antibody depleted is significantly reduced in the rituximab group. And partial or complete remission at 17 months also better in the rituximab group. And they have concluded that positive effect of rituximab on proteinuric remission occurred after 6 months. And these data suggest that anti-PLA2R level are early markers of rituximab effect, and that addition of rituximab to this non-immunosuppressive therapy does not affect the safety. This is the conclusion of the GEM Retux trial. So this is the study design. Rituximab was given at day 1 and day 8, and they have monitored based on the anti-PLA2R level. This is the pre-inclusion period where they studied it before the randomization. Next important study is the Mentor study, which was published in 2019 in AJM, where rituximab or cyclosporine in the treatment of the primary membranous nephropathy. So this is the visual abstract of the study. It was done in North America, and there was a run-in period, and the patients were divided into either the rituximab or the cyclosporine group. 65 patients were randomized. The dose regimen I will explain in the subsequent slide. If you look at the remission rate at 12 month and 24 month, it was 60% in the rituximab and 52% in the cyclosporine group. And they have shown that in this randomized non-inferiority trial comparing cyclosporine to rituximab in the treatment of the primary membranous nephropathy, rituximab was non-inferior in inducing complete or partial remission at 12 months and was superior in maintaining the long-term proteinuric remission. See, remission at 24 months was superior in this rituximab group. So they have shown that rituximab is as non-inferior to cyclosporine. So this is the dose regimen they have used in this study. Rituximab given on two doses, day 1 and day 15. And cyclosporine was given at a dose of 3 to 5 mg per kg, and the target trough level was mean of 150 nanogram per ml. So this is the dose regimen they used in the Mentor trial. Next important trial is the STARMID trial, which was published this year. This is the abstract of the STARMID trial. This is the sequential therapy with the tacrolimus and rituximab, superior to this modified Ponticelli regimen in inducing persistent remission in primary membranous nephropathy. It was done between 2014 to 2017. This is the modified Ponticelli regimen group, and this is the sequential tacrolimus plus rituximab group. If we see the complete or partial remission at 24 months, complete remission at 24 months, almost comparable, but this modified Ponticelli was better than this one, as we see in the lab rate. And they have concluded that treatment with corticosteroid, this modified Ponticelli regimen, induced remission of nephrotic syndrome in a significant greater number of patients than treatment with the tacrolimus and the rituximab group. And this is the study design, where the 6 months of modified Ponticelli was given. Here the tacrolimus was given at 180th day, that is at the end of the 6 month, 1 gram of rituximab was given. This was the study design. Tacrolimus, I think the trough level was 5 to 10 nanogram per ml. So here is the dose. This is the 5 to 7. The group 1 received modified Ponticelli, group 2 received the oral tacrolimus at the dose of 0.05 milligram per kg with the target of 5 to 7 nanogram per ml. At day 180, they received 1 gram tacrolimus dose, and then the 1 gram rituximab, then the tacrolimus was reduced by 25% every month with complete withdrawal at the 9th month. And both the group received oral Ceftron 3 times a week. So they have concluded that this modified Ponticelli was better. Thus, the old is definitely gold as far as the membranous nephropathy is concerned. Future trials might be enable us to achieve a fine balance between like the newer drug is better, they are better than the modified Ponticelli regimen or not, are yet to come. So this is the conclusion of the STARMID trial. The other important one is the RICYCLO trial. This is the rituximab or cyclophosphamide in the treatment of primary membranous nephropathy. This also published recently. The study design is They have included 74 patients, and they have randomized to receive the modified Ponticelli or the rituximab. Rituximab was given on day 1 and day 15 at a dose of 1 gram. And they have shown that the cyclical regimen tended to induce complete remission earlier. Rituximab appeared to have a delayed effect. And throughout the follow-up, the probability of achieving partial or complete remission was similar in the study arm. There is no much difference between the two groups. This is what it has shown. While not significantly different, the point estimate of 1 year probability of complete remission was lower in the rituximab arm. So this is the dose regimen they have used. Rituximab was given at day 1 and day 15 at a dose of 1 gram. And they have concluded that there was no signal of benefit or less harm associated with the rituximab group versus this modified Ponticelli. So the recent important trials that we have seen are GemRetux, Mentor, Starman, and RICYCLO. These are the important landmark trial which was published recently. A few lines about the KDIGO guidelines in the initial therapy of primary membranous nephropathy. There is a 1B recommendation for 6 months course of this alternating steroids plus the alkylating agent. Cyclophosphamide was preferred over the chlorambucil because of the risk of malignancy with chlorambucil. And the patient can be managed for at least 6 months following the completion of this modified pontocilli. 6 months we have to wait before declaring the patient as treatment failure. And if there is no remission, unless kidney function is deteriorating or the patient is developing potentially life-threatening symptoms related to the nephrotic syndrome, we can wait before starting the alternate treatment. Second, about the alternative regimen. Use of this CNI for a period of 6 months in patients who meet the criteria for initial therapy but who choose not to receive this modified pontocilli regimen, CNI can be used for 6 months. CNI have to be continued if the patient didn't achieve complete or partial remission after 6 months of treatment. Suppose if a patient is resistant to the initial therapy, suppose if they are resistant to the modified pontocilli regimen, CNI can be tried. If they are resistant to the CNI based therapy, modified pontocilli can be tried. Suppose if a patient of primary membranous nephropathy relapses, it is always better to choose a drug with which patient achieved the initial remission. If a 6 month cyclic modified pontocilli regimen was used for initial therapy, the regimen can be repeated only once for the treatment of the relapse as per the 2B recommendation. So, this is the topic proper, landmark trials in membranous nephropathy. It started in 1946. Just to remember the 30% of spontaneous remission and 30% of complete remission and other ESRD risk as I described in the previous slide. In 1946, they have described this membranous nephropathy. In 1979, steroid 1 is introduced. 84, pontocilli regimen, chlorambucil and steroid was better. In 1998, modified pontocilli where cyclophosphamide plus steroid combination was better than this. Then subsequently about CNI trial came, then subsequently Gem/Rituxan trial where it showed rituximab was better than the non-immunosuppressive drugs. If we add, there is a better achievement of remission and anti-PLA2 response. Mentor trial compared rituximab versus cyclosporine. Starman showed no much difference and the modified pontocilli was better. And Ricyclo also showed modified pontocilli was better. So 1, 2, 3, 7 important landmark trials which are related to this. In between, the trial which is about anti-PLA2 or ACTH can also be introduced in this. So thank you.